Okay. So here we go. Chapter 2, dealing a little bit with pain. Okay. So did y'all cover pain with Miss Johnny any? Okay. So y'all have done this a lot. Okay. So I am going to skip a lot of it then and just get to the stuff that's relevant for me. Is that a deal? Okay. We'll do that then. Okay. So let's talk about, yes. Okay. So number one, you already know, apparently you've learned a lot about pain as it is. So we know what it is, an unpleasant sensory or emotional experience. Usually pain coming from your body is a warning sign. It's trying to tell you to either A, don't do something, or to do something. Pain is usually picked up in the body. So our body perceives pain through specific cells called nociceptors. So the cells in our body that are responsible for communicating pain are called nociceptors. And the way that that works is nociceptors are attached to different parts of our bodies. Once they experience pain, they're going to carry the pain from that area of the body into your spinal cord, and ultimately from the spinal cord to the brain in some very specific areas. And that's kind of what we're going to cover today. How does pain travel? So just know that pain is picked up in the body through cells called nociceptors or pain receptors. Okay, so that's on the first page. We're going to keep jumping. Oh, well, no, let's do this. No, okay. Okay, let's see here. Yep, so I'll skip that because that's something you've dealt with. You understand the difference of medical management of pain, the difference between anesthesia, which is when someone receives some type of pain-reducing agent that numbs pain. So if I have an anesthesia, if I have an anesthetic, that means I'm going to have my pain numbed. I don't feel anything. There's no sensation. Versus analgesia is the state where your pain is reduced, or the pain is reduced to the point where it actually can go away. That's what we do as therapy. We don't use anesthesia. We don't inject medicine and cause you to not feel anything. It's just numb. We use analgesia. Our job is to produce sensory analgesia for pain reduction. So that's going to be our main thing that we'll do there. Okay, so that's number two thing that I wanted to talk about. Y'all already understand acute pain versus chronic pain. See, we're going to skip through a lot of this. You already understand kind of, sort of, referred pain. Did y'all go through referred pain? So, okay, y'all understand that. We'll go back through dermatomes as a part of this chapter. So we are going to go through that, but not right now. We'll cover it shortly. But dermatomes are really important. Dermatomes are areas of skin that coordinate with specific spinal levels. So just like we're able to go down the spine, we have areas of skin that are responsible for those spinal levels. And we can trace it all the way down. So you can, as far up as the neck, so the neck is C3, the upper shoulder here is C4, the outer shoulder is C5, the lateral arm down to the thumb and the index finger is C6, the middle finger is C7. So if you're in the car and somebody is driving and you feel like you need to salute them, tell them, I see seven you. You'll get it tomorrow, don't worry. C7. Okay, C8, T1 coming up the medial side of the arm. And literally what it's doing when you look at it from a dermatome map. Hey, yeah. Oh yes, thank you, thank you, thank you. Appreciate it. My headphones, I need those. Thank you, thank you, thank you. When you look at it on a dermatome map, I want to say, what dermatome map did I look at that I actually liked? There are not a lot of them I actually like, because a lot of them are confusing and ridiculous. But I found it on something, and I really liked it. I think it's in one of these. Let's see if I put it in chapter 5. Is it in here? Yes, yes, this is the one I actually like. So it's in this chapter 5. Crap. It's in this chapter 5 PowerPoint. This is the one I actually like, dermatome map. Because I think this is the most well-drawn one. You can look these up online. They're horribly drawn a lot of times. This one was the most well-drawn dermatome map I've seen in a long time. So upper neck, you know, right underneath the chin, 2, 3, 4, coming out to the upper shoulder, 5 over the deltoid, coming down mid-arm, 6, lateral arm again, C7, the middle finger, and some of this slightly in the hand, C8 is coming more medial up to about the wrist, T1 is going to be medial forearm, T2 is going to be going underneath the arm, and so into the armpit, T2 is in the armpit. So the best way to think of a dermatome map to really make life easy for you, always remember it's going to go from lateral to medial, going in the upper extremity. So if you get confused and go, I don't know where that is, always think it starts lateral to medial. So here, after C4, everything else is lateral. Lateral, 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 lateral. C8, medial, medial, medial. And it's the exact opposite for the lower body. It starts medial and works its way lateral. L1, groin. L2, medial thigh. L3, medial knee. L4, anterior knee. Medial shin to the great toe. L5, lateral thigh. Lateral shin, toes 2 through 4. S1, going so medial to lateral, is coming lateral on the lateral edge of the foot, coming up the back of the leg, S1. And then you have S2, S3, and S4. So S2 is lateral leg, S3 is medial, S4, S5 is dealing with the perianal region. And then we have stuff in the trunk that's really important. It's really hard to find how to do the trunk, so we don't try to slice the trunk up from a therapeutic standpoint. We tell you the most important things on the trunk. T4 is the line of the nipple, so it is truly the nipple line. T10 is the umbilicus, or the belly button. So probably the weirdest question I've ever had from a student, and I didn't even know if I wanted to answer it, but I guess I had to. It was a student question. One student, I don't remember what class it was in, they asked me the weirdest question. They said, what if the person has really large breast material and the line of the nipple is not aligning with, and I'm like, I don't even know how to answer that question. But T4 is still that line, no matter where it's sitting on the anatomy. See how smart I am? I told you. I'm just here so I don't get fined. Okay, so that was that. So we'll go through dermatome maps to help you, but that's probably the best dermatome map I've seen in a long time. So it's really, really good. So we'll go through dermatome. And the reason why is when we start to treat pain, there are ways we treat pain that actually follow the line of the dermatome. We'll talk about different ways we can treat it, but one of the ways we treat it is using the line of the dermatome to treat it. So it's going to be important that you do it. Okay, we're jumping all the way over to pain assessment now. There are multiple ways you can measure pain. Probably the most used methodologies are the visual analog pain scale. That's where the patient will go through and mark on that. A numeric pain rating scale is probably the most used in therapy. That's simply where you ask the patient, you know, on a scale of 1 to 10, how do you feel? You know, rate your pain on 1 to 10. I'm a 6, I'm a 7, I'm whatever. So visual analog, they go through and mark it, but on the numeric pain rating scale, they give you a number. One of the most researched pain methodologies you can use is the McGill Pain Questionnaire. I'll upload that on Canvas so you can look at it. We're not gonna test you on it, but it is good to just know in case you go on a clinical and they use the McGill, you'll be familiar with what it is. The book does kind of mention it. The McGill is made up of 7 parts and attempts to measure perception of pain. There is a body diagram for pain location and word descriptions that go along with it. The advantages include collecting quantitative and qualitative data. So what does that mean, quantitative, qualitative? Quantitative, Q-U-A-N-T, means we collect a number on pain. 1 to 10, 1 to 20, 1 to 100. We're collecting a number. Quantitative, when you think of quantitative, think of quantity. How many of something I have. If I'm going to go to the store, they'll ask you, you know, if you're buying bananas, what's the quantity? 3, 4, 6. You're buying oranges, you get 12 in a bushel, whatever. So quantity. Qualitative means you get description of things that don't have numbers. So I get things like how my pain is actually feeling. Numb, tingle, burn, stabbing, aching, throbbing. I get descriptions of pain that don't have numbers. So the McGill brings in multiple ways of assessing pain. That's why people love it. It's probably the most used pain questionnaire out there, the McGill pain scale. Then again, visual analog, we talked about that. Patients can mark on that and tell you where they are. They can look at it and do that. And then the numeric one, again, is the one that's most used probably in all clinical settings. The problem I don't like with the numeric one is there is no standardization for it. So how you perceive pain may be different than how someone else perceives pain. If you're great with pain, you may give a 1 or 2 number when in reality you may be a 6 or 7. Or you could be, malingering. That's a beautiful word. You all ever heard of that word? It's a cool term. You'll hear it certainly as you continue to go into your therapy career. Malingering. I don't even know if I know how to spell it. That's what I say. I think it's M-A-L-I-N-G-E-R-I-N-G. That may be spelled wrong. I don't know. But essentially, it's a fancy word for saying you're dragging out your pain or your problems when there's really no evidence that you still have the issue going on. So it's a fancy word for saying people are faking. You're faking. There's nothing wrong with you. You're still, oh God, I'm dying. Oh God, I'm dying. You know, those are the people that are gonna come in clinically and they're smiling and they're high-fiving people and they're jumping up on the table and laying back and they're just hanging out smiling. And you go, what's your pain number? Oh, I'm a 10. No, you can't be a 10. I've been in 10 out of 10, well, close to it. And I wasn't smiling, I wanted to kill people. It was the worst pain I'd ever dealt with in my life. And so you have to start quantifying what a 10 means. So you're a 10, I'm a 10 out of 10. So that means if I go to my car and get my chainsaw and I come back and I saw your arm off, you're not gonna hurt any worse than you're hurting now. Oh yeah, it'll be worse, you're not a 10. So let's back that number down, you're not a 10. So that's the only problem with numeric scales. They're good, but they can be overused by people to say something is more wrong with them than it really is. Okay. So now we are where I need us to be. We're going to learn some neurology. So you're going to learn some neuro terms and some cool things about how we start to control pain. Okay, so it says pain perception, or how we perceive pain. The first statement is probably the most functional statement you'll read. I know this won't make sense, but the mechanisms of how we perceive pain are not completely understood. Even though we have pieces of the puzzle, we don't 1,000% know what's going on to signal pain. For pain to be perceived by my brain of any sort, whether that's a toothache, whether that's me stepping on my son's Hot Wheels in the morning trying to turn on the lights, whether that's kicking your foot on your bed while you're getting up trying to go to the bathroom, whether that's banging your knee on the desk trying to stand up, whatever pain you've had recently, for that pain to be perceived or to be communicated to the brain, it must first be picked up by a sensory receptor in the body known as the periphery. Anytime you see the word periphery, it's just a fancy word for body. My body is perceiving the pain somehow. The pain has been communicated from an area to a nociceptor, and now the nociceptor's job is to carry that information to my brain to let me know something is going on. So it has to first be picked up by a nociceptor in the periphery. Okay? So pain receptors, specialized receptors called nociceptors, signal actual or potential tissue damage. They signal to let the body know something is going on. Not all pain is actually because something is hurting. Some pain can be a warning. It's trying to keep you from injuring yourself. So there are times if you're running and you cut too fast and you almost tear a knee ligament, you'll feel a strain or a pull and you'll get pain. It didn't tear it, but it lets you know you went too far. So it has to give you a signal. The receptors in the skin, the receptors in the skin are understood better than other places, so we understand how pain is communicated from our skin. The nociceptors are three distinct types of free nerve endings that respond to different stimuli. So it's three different types of them, and they respond to different stimuli. Okay? We're not going to go crazy and figure all those out. Just know that they are responding to it. Okay. The nerve fiber types that are the mediators of pain impulses in the brain are A delta and C fiber. So that's good to know. So remember on that strength duration curve, I showed you A delta and C fiber. So A delta was in the line with the three, C fiber was way over to the right in alignment with denervated muscle. These are the cell types that communicate pain up to our brain. So we have two pathways going on. So let's do this. Let me erase this so we can understand pain. This is a crude understanding, so it's not like you're, oh crap, I think it's that board. I do. I think it's this board that's on the thing. Okay. Alrighty. Here we go. Okay. So let's talk about perception of pain. We're going to walk this down. Okay, so this will be our brain. This is our spinal cord. And this is an area of body. So somebody give me, outside of the headaches, the last place you've had pain. Arm. Okay. Anywhere in specific? Okay. Bicep. Probably put your hand on here. Okay. Bicep. Hey, I didn't get an art degree. I went to therapy school. Bicep. Okay. So we have this bicep. Okay. What kind of pain was it? Throbbing pain. Okay. So we now have a throbbing pain happening here in the biceps. Okay. So what happens is some event caused her bicep to start throbbing. Did you do anything? Lifting weights? Carrying people, sack of potatoes, what were we doing? Lifting. 100-pound curls. Okay. I give it that. 100-pound curls. Okay. So after 100-pound curls, now we start to feel pain. So what happens is the bicep is going to communicate that information to a nociceptor. So there's a nociceptor here inside of the muscle. Communicates that information to the nociceptor. The nociceptor takes that information into the spinal cord. The spinal cord is then responsible for taking that information up to the brain and getting it to the area where sensory information is processed. That's the flow of information from the body. So it goes to a nociceptor, and then after it goes to a nociceptor, I forgot to put that. So it goes from a nociceptor, then it's going to go, as the book tells us, it's going to use a fiber type to communicate. So nociceptors are in the muscle, but then nociceptors communicate pain here, and these are pain fibers. And they're either A delta or C fiber pain fibers. And each one does something specific. A delta is going to communicate what we call fast pain. Like it gets to your brain quick. Whew, zing. Say you're walking and you're not paying attention. Ha ha, hee hee, ho ho. Slam your leg on it. Ah! Fast pain. You immediately know, ouch, I'm hurting. A delta does that. Aching, throbbing type pain, C fiber does that. Slow pain is what we call that. That's going to be C fiber. Dull, like, no, it doesn't have to be dull, but aching, throbbing pain, slow communication pain is going to be C fiber pain. So nociceptors communicate information to different pain fibers that are in the body, and then those fibers communicate that information to the spinal cord, and then finally up to the brain. Okay, so it says A delta fibers communicate, or they are sensitive to crude touch, pain, and temperature. C fibers are afferent fibers coming from pain receptors in the body. So A delta picks up on things like crude touch. When we say crude, that doesn't mean somebody touches you in a way you don't like it. Like, don't grab my arm. That's really crude. No. Crude meaning it's non-discriminate, non-distinct touch. Like tickle. If somebody were to hold your arms up and tickle you, you couldn't tell exactly which finger was making you laugh. you just say, oh, that tickles. It's all over the place. You feel it all over the place. Crude touch. It's not one point. You can't just point to it and go, ouch, I hurt here. That's discriminative touch. I can find one spot. Crude touch, it feels like it's all over the place. So A delta picks up crude touch, pain and temperature. C fiber picks up more slow base pain, dull pain, throbbing, aching type pain, and it's a very slow communicator. Okay. So good there. So these are some of the cells. These are some of the cells inside of the body that have nociceptive function. Free nerve endings are the main one. So nociceptors have a lot of free nerve endings, but there are some other ones that communicate pain as well. Okay, so again, so that's a good slide to kind of go through what we were talking about. Again, A delta and C, their size does matter. So I definitely want to review that. A delta pain fibers are going to be small myelinated fiber, which means they don't hold a lot of information, but they travel quickly. So myelination makes it travel quickly. Same thing like putting your hand on the hot stove. You want myelinated fibers communicating that. You don't want dull, slow, achy, barely getting to the brain communication. You want quick, fast, ouch, my hand is burning, move quickly. That's A delta. Okay? So that's what they look like. C fibers are going to be small, unmyelinated fibers. So they won't even have the myelin. So that's why they communicate at a much slower pace. Dull, achy sensations, burning, it communicates that kind of stuff. Not like my skin is being burned because something's hot on it. Burning like I have a burning sensation. Like sometimes where you feel something is being pinched and it feels like it's burning. It's like almost a deeper level of throbbing. It feels like it's burning. It's that kind of information. Okay. Okay. All right. So this is just good information to know where the pain is coming from and what do I expect to have it. So if I'm dealing with musculoskeletal pain, which is what we treat a lot of, we want to ask patients, what type of pain are you having? If it's dull, aching, kind of hard to localize, that kind of sounds more musculoskeletal. Cutaneous means something on or around the skin or slightly beneath, sharp prickling or tingling. Easy to localize. Man, I feel it right here. And then visceral pain, meaning it's coming from a structure other than the musculoskeletal system or the cutaneous part of the body, will be dull and very hard to localize. It'll refer really all over the place. So you can have gallbladder pain that refers to your left arm. You can have kidney pain that refers to your low back. You can have, trying to think of some other one. You're starting to have a heart attack and it's referring down the left arm and up into your jaw. So that's visceral pain. It's coming from something inside the body, but it's producing it somewhere else. Okay, so now let's talk about how we communicate pain. We know where it comes from. Nociceptors that dumps it off to fiber types. So nociceptors can be free nerve endings. They can be a couple of things. But it's going to dump that information into nerve cells or dump them into different nerve fiber types connected to them to carry that information from our body to our brain. So we get that. So A delta and C fiber. Okay, so let's walk us through this process. So it says once a pain receptor has been stimulated, so give me something. What's something else that has caused you pain? We've gotten headache. We've gotten bicep pain from curls. Hand pain from? Ow. That's a whole nother level. Now I know I don't need to bother cows. I thought cows were docile. That's not a cow. That's a almost like a pet. Yeah, that's not, I don't know. I got to hang around with more cows. I've never been around them that much. But, okay, slam the hand against the gate. Immediately when that cow slammed your hand against that gate, what did you do?
My hand was.
Ha. And what did you do after that? We're going to tell you why you do that. Or if you hurt and you rub it, like, why does that hurt so bad? We'll tell you why you do these things. There's actually a reason why you do those things. Okay, so once you receive pain, once pain is stimulated, once the receptor, the nociceptor is stimulated, then it transmits the information from the nociceptor to a nerve fiber. So it's going to go from the nociceptor, which is in the skin, to a nerve fiber, either a delta, depending on what type of pain it is, if it's something that needs to be communicated really quickly, or if it's something that's dull and achy, it's going to be transmitted to C. But either way, it's going to go from the pain receptor to the nerve fiber, and then the nerve fiber's job is to transmit a signal from that place on your body to the dorsal horn of your spinal cord. So that's where we really want to kind of start to look. So this looks really weird, but all this is a half version of a spinal cord. So this is a good way of looking at it here. So this would be a slice of your spinal cord here somewhere in the body, a slice of your spinal cord. So this would be like if we took the spinal cord that's running down through the vertebral canal and we sliced it vertically and looked down on it. So imagine we sliced the spinal cord and now we're looking down on it, like we're looking at this electrode. So this would be the spinal cord. So think about the spinal cord being stacked like this all the way up and down, vertical like this. So this would be the head. The spinal cord is running down in stacks like this. We took the spinal cord and we sliced it in half, and now we're looking down on it like this. Make sense? So this is the view you're looking at right now. I'm looking down on the spinal cord like this. I guess it would be like this, because this part would be the front. So this would be the front here. This would be the front end closest to your belly button, or closest to the front side of your body. And this would be the back side closest to your spinous process. So that's what you're looking at. So you're looking down on it. Okay, so information is going to travel from the nerve fiber, either A delta or C, into your spinal cord, into the dorsal horn. Dorsal is just a fancy word for back. So it's going to travel to the back side of your spinal cord. So it's going to travel back here to the back side of the spinal cord. Okay? So, so we have So we have pain fiber stimulated. Then after that, we have what we would call our first order neuron communication. First order neuron communication. And that's going to be from the neuron in the body. So after the pain fiber and is communicated to the pain neuron, A delta or C, first order is going to take it from there to the spinal cord. And then it's going to synapse. And synapse is just a fancy word for it's going to connect. It's going to land there. It's going to land in that spot. It's going to connect on that spot. Dorsal horn of the spinal cord. So it goes from the pain receptor is stimulated. After that, it communicates the information to the neuron. First order neuron communication is from that neuron up to the spinal cord into the dorsal horn. That's where we go first. Okay? On the dorsal horn, it's going to connect with specific areas called lamina areas. Lamina areas. So a lamina area is nothing but a fancy word for a strip on the spinal cord. So it's just a strip. Anything that you deal with strips, the spinal cord has strips on it. So this is the same as this. It's just magnified to now show you the dorsal horn. So that's the dorsal horn from the other picture. It's this here just magnified to look like that. And here you can see the different strips or lamina areas already highlighted. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Or all the way down. So 4, 5. So different lamina. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So it's going to connect on the dorsal horn in different lamina areas or different strip areas of the dorsal horn. The primary area where it's going to connect is lamina area 3, right here. Lamina area 3, the yellow. And that area has a name, and it's called substantia gelatinosum. It's in the book, in case you think I'm crazy. Not yet. Hold that thought. We're getting there. Hold that thought. So this is not the columns yet. Columns are another order, but we're headed there. So first order is going to go from, it's going to go from the periphery, wherever I hurt, from the periphery into the dorsal horn. So this information, this afferent information is coming in here, going into the dorsal horn of the spinal cord, where it's ultimately going to synapse in all of the different lamina areas, but primarily in lamina area 3, substantia gelatinosa. So that's where pain from the periphery goes first. Any pain you have started from the periphery, was picked up from the periphery, ended up in lamina area 3, substantia gelatinosa in your spinal cord. Okay. Okay. After it synapses in lamina area 3, it can't just stay in my spinal cord, because now I still don't know what to do with it. It would be just like I laid my hand on a hot stove and the information only went as far as my spinal cord. Well, my spinal cord doesn't tell me what to do about my hand on the stove, so it's just going to stay there. I need to get information where? To the brain. I can't just stop here in the spinal cord. It's got to go to the brain. How do we get information from the spinal cord to the brain? We use Ubers for the brain. Oh, which door? We use Uber Eats. There we go. We use Ubers for the body. Your body has built-in Ubers even before Uber was a thing. Except they're not called Ubers, they're called tracks. Told you we were getting there. So the way the body works is it has to have a way of taking stuff from one area to the area where it needs to go to get something done. And those are called tracks. So once the information gets to lamina area 3, oh crap. So lamina 3, and I just put SG, substantia gelatinosa. So after it synapses there, now pain is going to get out of that car. So it gets out of the A delta C fiber car, and now it's going to jump in an Uber and go from the spinal cord up to my brain. And this is called our second order neuron communication. It's going to go, so it goes from substantia gelatinosa or lamina 3. It's going to go from there. It's going to then jump in a tract that's responsible for carrying it. So it's jumping in a tract that's responsible for it. Most of the time, that tract is called the spinothalamic tract. So it's going to go from spinal cord, spinothalamic tract, to the brain, specifically to the thalamus. So now we're taking information from the spinal cord. So we moved it from the spinal cord. So here from the periphery into the spinal cord. Now we're going to take it from the spinal cord all the way up to the brain to this place here called the thalamus, which is inside of your brain. So that's a bad picture of a thalamus. I'll show you what the thalamus is, because it looks like on that picture the thalamus is not a part of your brain, but it is. So this is a half picture of your brain. So if you take your brain, you have a left and a right hemisphere. Right in the middle of the brain is the thalamus. So it's taking the information from your spinal cord up to your thalamus. Okay? So your thalamus works as a distribution center for your brain. Think of it like an Amazon warehouse. Its job is to send stuff out to where it needs to be. It gets all kind of information sent to it, and then it processes this information and sends it where it needs to go. It packages up, puts it in the right box, puts the address on it, sends it out to where it needs to go. That's the job of the thalamus. It's like an Amazon warehouse. So second order neurons go from the spinal cord or the spinal thalamic tract specifically up to the middle part of your brain to a place called the thalamus, which is like an Amazon warehouse. I don't know why I'm clumsy today. I swear I hadn't dropped this much stuff in a long time. And then finally, once it gets to the thalamus's job is to send it where it needs to go. And that's called third order neuron communication. This is when now the information is going to leave from the thalamus to the primary somatosensory cortex in the brain. That's the highest part of your brain that's responsible for processing all of the information going on with your body. The primary somatosensory cortex. And I'll show you where that is. It's right, it's right here. So the thalamus is deep in here, deep to this structure here, and it's going to send it up to this cortex, the somatosensory cortex. So that's how pain gets from our periphery, from our body, whether that's our leg, ankle, foot, knee, shoulder, back, hip, thigh, whatever area you have had pain in, head, elbow, you name it. If it's painful, it's going to travel that way in those three orders of neurons. From the nociceptor cell in the skin that picks up pain all the way to the brain in the somatosensory cortex. That's how information is communicated. Okay. Any question there? Okay. It's signaling more times, yeah. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So it's trying to get your attention faster. Mm-hmm. Okay. Good stuff. Okay. So that's where we're going. So that's ascending, the primary somatosensory cortex. Okay, now, that's a good place for a break. I don't want to wear you out there. Take five.